Good morning to everybody. Thank you very much for coming to our seminar of the Department of Statistics and Mathematics and Computer Science, and also the Center of Operations Research, and to the PhD program in Statistics Optimization and Applied Mathematics. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Michel Terrat. He's a very well-known colleague and also a close friend. We met him 15 years ago.
Many times ago.
And well, he's emeritus professor in the University of Limoges in France. He was president of the French Society for Industrial and Applied Mathematics. And since 2012, okay, he's working as a researcher in our group, in our project for the ministry. I see the acknowledgement here. Economy and Competitiveness. And this is not the first time here, so we know quite well. But in any case, okay, I will say just three numbers. About 120 papers, more than 1,000 sites, by more than 500 authors. No. So I think this is enough presentation.
You don't.
And we are completely yours.
Thank you. Juan, you know more than me about this. Okay, so effectively, I'm very glad to be here and also to have a research program with Juan, Lola, Javier, and in University of Miguel Hernandez, and also with my friend Marco Lopez in Alicante. Okay, and so as you said, this is supported by this grant, and I am also a member of a group in Australia around Kruger, Alexander Kruger, and also a member of this program in Paris, but the talk is not related to this program, but they asked me to advise. So I do it. So the talk today is about perturbation of error bounds, and I have been working in this domain since many years. I started with Wing Van Nye, who was my PhD student and who is now professor in Vietnam. And to this work, Alexander Kruger joined, and recently also Marco Lopez. And so today I will try to give a background on error bounds and also give some new results. I hope I will succeed to attract you to this domain. Okay? So the talk is based mainly on this paper. So the first paper with Kruger and Guy and me, and which were accepted and published in CIOPT. And recently, this paper about perturbation of error bounds, which is which has just appeared in Mathematical Programming, and it is included. It will be included in the special issue dedicated to the 80th birthday of Thierry Rockefeller. Okay, so the outline of the talk is the following. I will give some background on error bounds and also on the history of error bounds. And I will concentrate the talk on the stability of local error bounds and give some words only on global error bounds at the end of the talk. Okay? And as you will see, this part will be divided in three sections. One where I will introduce sub-differential criteria, so-called sub-differential criteria. In the second part, I will describe what we are calling epsilon perturbation. Because I am in the center where people are mainly working in some infinite programming, I will give some infinite some result on infinite constraint systems. Okay, so you will like it. okay, so this presentation is mainly concerned with the study of inequality systems of this type. Okay, try to find x in a space x, mainly finite dimensional space, such that f of x is less than or equal to zero, where f is an extended real valued function, which means that f can take the value plus infinity as it is usually in optimization. And you know that this kind of system, for instance, subsume feasible sets in mathematical programming. When you have a finite family of inequalities of this type, fi of x less than or equal to zero, if you define this function f of x as the maximum of the component at x, then these systems is exactly can be exactly rewritten as this system here. So, and an important issue when you study this system of inequality system of type 1 is to give an upper estimate, what we call an error bound, of the distance from x upon h in x to the set S of f, to this set, okay? In terms of computable function measuring the violation of the inequality one. Okay? So, in order to do that, we define what we call a local error bound. And we say that an external real function f admits a local error bound at a point x in the set S sub f if we can find a real tau strictly positive, such that the tau times the distance from x to sf, to the set sf, is less than or equal to f plus of x for x near x bar, a point x bar, a given point x bar, where, as usual, the notation f plus of x means the maximum of f of x and zero, the positive part of the function f. Okay? Similarly, we can define global error bound, and global error bound, it's exactly the same definition, but instead of having this inequality for x in the neighborhood of x bar, you have this inequality globally on the given set x for all x in x. Okay? And we can define with respect to this the exact upper bound of such all tau satisfying 2 or satisfying 2 prime when it is for every x in x. And this defines what we call Rf of x bar, which is a lim inf when x goes to x bar and f of x is strictly positive of this quotient f of x over the distance from x to S of f. This is in a local setting, and in the global setting, it doesn't depend on x bar, of course, on the point. It's exactly this formula 4. Okay? This is the definition. And so, in a simple example, you see that in this case you have an error bound, and in this case you don't have error bound at zero. So, local error bound, I mean. Okay? And now, you have for people working in a set value analysis, there is the concept of metric subregularity, or more general, of metric regularity. Okay? And so when you have a multifunction from x to y, and you take x bar and y bar in the graph, X bar and Y bar in the graph means that Y bar belongs to f of X bar, because you are in the set valued setting. F of X is a set, a subset of Y. Okay, you are going from X to the set in Y. And so you take X bar and Y bar in the graph of F. And the general problem in a variational analysis is to solve an equation Y belongs to F of X, what we call a generalized equation. It means that you have to find a solution X with data belonging to F of X, Y belonging to F of X, and this you have to find this locally around the point X bar Y bar in the graph of F, which means that since F is a set valued mapping, you can define the inverse of F, F minus 1. Okay, it means that this solving Y belongs to F of X is equivalent to solving Y belongs to F minus 1 of Y. Okay, and sometimes it's easier to see what is the inverse than what is F. Okay, but in the R programming, for instance, if you have this inequality, you have a matrix A, and so you have this inequality AX less than or equal to Y. Okay, if you set F of X, the set value mapping, set F of X equal A of X plus the positive Horton in Rn, then, okay, solving this inequality is exactly the same as solving this generalized equation related to this function F. Okay, and in the general set value setting, you can define what we call metric regularity of a multifunction F at the point X bar, Y bar in the graph of F. It means that you have a constant tau such that the distance of X from X to the inverse F minus 1 at Y bar is less than equal to the distance of Y bar to F of X, and for X near X bar. Okay? This is a weaker notion than metric regularity because it involves only X at near X bar and not Y also near Y bar. And in fact, you see that the quotient between the distance to a true solution and to the measure error, which is exactly this quotient, the distance from X to F minus 1 of Y bar over the distance of Y bar to F of X, is exactly metric regularity, means that this quotient, okay, is bounded above near X, okay? X bar. This property provides an estimate of how far a candidate X can be from the solution set of Y belongs to F of X. Okay, and it is well known in set value analysis that the following are equivalent. F is metrically subregular at the point X bar, Y bar in the graph of F. F minus 1 is calm, and the distance of Y bar to the F dot has a local error bound at X bar. And so, I remember just, but here we have a specialist of calmness in this university. The F minus 1 is calm if and only if there exists a constant. So, F minus 1 at Y bar X bar, because you have to reverse the points, if there is a constant L such that you have this, okay? Calmness, you see, is related to metric subregularity. F is equivalent to F is calm if and only if F minus 1 is metrically subregular. Okay, and a part of this result goes back, but many people are involved in this, but goes back, for instance, to result by Henrion, Jourani, Ouattara. By the way, Arion also is a part of the group in Elche. So you see, we have you have specialists of calmness here, inside and outside. Okay? And now some history about Eurobound. So the theory of Eurobound goes back more or less to the work of Hoffman in 1952, who established for linear function in finite dimensions the following result. So you have a matrix, M times N matrix, and vector B in Rm, okay? And he says that there is a positive number kappa, strictly positive, such that the distance from X to the set of x in Rn such that a of x is less than or equal to b as an upper bound given by this number, and this number is exactly, you have this sign plus, it means that this number is the maximum of the component with zero, okay? And so this is the first result related to upper bound, okay, in the linear setting. And from there, people have been interested to go from the linear convex and to the non-convex setting. And I can cite in this direction many authors. And the first one, in my opinion, but it's not only in my opinion, it's a general opinion, it's Robinson in 1975, and Mangasarian also, who extended to convex, Ostender and Kruzex, Peng, Lewis and Peng, and after many people, of course, including Henrion again, Kruger, Utrata, Klatte, Lee, Jourani, Thibault, many people are missing, and also Joffe, of course, Aze in France, Kovalec, and also my work with Ngai in the late 90s, okay? But this is from convex to non-convex functions. But also Eurobounds, there are many papers in connection with metric regularity and metric sub-regularity. The Bible, I will say, is a book by Donchev and Rockefeller in 2014, where you can find everything inside about this and in the references, okay? But before the book, of course, many people have worked in this direction. And Aubin in France, and more recently, but it's not in the listed in the right, because this is earlier Joffe, for instance, Joffe Utrata, also my work with Ngai and Kruger. NJ is did a lot of work in this direction. Penaud, but this guy Ferrer in Germany, and many others. I forget to mention many other people. Okay, but I want to advertise this group of colleagues and friends, because they are doing a very nice work in this direction, in calmness, in subregularity, and in application to infinite semi-infinite programming. Okay. And but also this theory has connection with weak sharp minima. And for instance, Burke, Deng, but also this guy from Chinese University of Hong Kong, NJ. And you have also Jane Ye, many other people. I cannot cite everybody here. And Also, Eurobonds has many applications, and it's involved in many applications. And for instance, in what we call the feasibility problem. And many people working in this area are Bauschke Bowen, Beck and Tobol, S and Luck, recently in 2013. And this feasibility problem consists in finding a point in the intersection of a finite family of closed, usually convex sets. And it has a broad applicability in many areas, such as, for instance, imaging. For instance, Patrick Combeck has many papers where he applies the feasibility problem. But more recently, this Luck, for instance, has many nice papers where he applies the error bounds to the convex, to the feasibility problem. And also, it has application in, in several iterative methods, such as the method of successive orthogonal projection. And you have also the same people, Bauschke, Sean Wong, these people are working in this. And also, in Israel, in Haifa, you have a sensor who is applying error bounds on cyclic subgradient projection methods. And And also, error bounds are application in the convergence analysis of projection algorithm. They allow to quantify the proximity of an iterate to the solution set of the problem. And Yoffe, Beck and Tobol, Lewis, Luck, Malik recently, Hess and Luck, what is, it's difficult to pronounce, but he's now in Washington, University of Washington, in the same university than Rockefeller, Dima. We call him Dima, but he's from Israel. And Bolt in France, for itself. And also Kruger and Tao is a student. He was a student of Tao. Now he's with Luck in Germany, in Göttingen. Yeah. Okay. So this is all I wanted to say for history, and now I want to introduce you to the new work we have done with Barco and Sacha Kruger on the stability of our bounds. Okay, and in order to do that, I will define a subdifferential. Everybody knows what is a subdifferential for a function. Okay. And this is what we call the convex subdifferential, or Fenchel Moreau Rockefeller subdifferential, the usual subdifferential for convex function. And I will define also what we call the subdifferential slope of f at x bar, which is the project, which is the set of points in the subdifferential of with minimal norm, the projection of zero on the subdifferential. Okay? This is a subdifferential slope. We have also the boundary subdifferential slope of f at x bar, which is the projection of zero on the boundary of the subdifferential. Okay? This means the boundary of the subdifferential of f at x bar. And this is a notation BD like boundary, okay? And we have also another concept, which is a strict outer subdifferential slope of f at x bar with this notation. This notation is due to Sacha Kruger, which is exactly the lim inf when x goes to x bar and when f of x goes to zero of the, of the subdifferential slope, okay? And for instance, just give a very simple example. If you take the function which is identically equal to zero, so obviously zero belongs to the subdifferential of f at x bar, for every x bar, by the way. And so the boundary slope is zero because the strict outer subdifferential slope is plus infinity. So you see that at this first example, you have not equality between the two slopes. Okay? And now if you take this other function, f of x equals zero for x negative and f of x equals x, you remember the first example on the left, then the subdifferential of f at zero, it is a convex function, the subdifferential of f at zero is the interval 0, 1, so of course zero belongs to the boundary, and the boundary slope is zero, while the strict outer subdifferential slope is 1. Okay? And now, I want to remind you, Juan and Lola, one of your nice results, recent result, by the way, with Antut and Javier. Okay? So, this is the following. If you have a function from Rn to R, which is convex, okay, so you prove in 2015 that it's theorem 3.1 of your paper, maybe you remember, so that the boundary slope, okay, is exactly the boundary, sorry, not slope, the boundary of the subdifferential is exactly the limb slope when x goes to x bar, x different of x bar of the subdifferential. Okay? And the boundary slope can be easily computed, and you found this nice formula that the boundary slope of f at x bar is exactly the limb nth of the distance from zero to the subdifferential of f, when x goes to x bar, okay, and x different from x bar. It was really nice. I remember that when I visited you some years ago, we were already discussing this kind of things, and you succeeded. Okay, nice. Okay, now, for instance, in the particular case where the function is polyhedral, okay, polyhedral means that f of x is the maximum of something of this type, ai of x minus bi, an affine function. It's the maximum of a finite family of affine functions. Okay? And so ai is in Rm, and again, now, another guy appears, it's Henrion, okay, Canovas, Henrion, Lopez, Parra in 2016, and theorem 3.1, so very precise, okay. So the we can prove that the limb slope of the subdifferential is exactly the union of the convex hull of this I when I belongs to a set D of x bar, which denotes a family of subset of indices, it's an indices, okay, such that this system here is consistent in the variable D in Rn. So also this is a very nice result, and not so easy to obtain. And okay, and from this we can prove that the strict outer subdifferential slope, with the notation we have in this paper, is a distance from zero to this convex hull of AI. So we can find precise precise formula for the subdifferential slope in this case. Okay? And in some simple example, we can, with the hand on the blackboard, okay, find this set easily and find exactly without any computer exactly what it is. Okay, so the starting point now is the following. Is a theorem, the theorem Sagittarius, is the symbol of Sagittarius. Okay, so you have a function f which is in gamma zero of x. Gamma zero of x means you have a lower semi-continuous convex function which is proper, which means that is not identically equal to plus infinity. Okay, remember that my function go can have extended real value, is extended real functional, and so it may take the value plus infinity. But it means that it's not equal to plus infinity. Okay, and so you suppose that f of x bar equals zero. And now this is the first, the theorem says that f has a local error bound at x bar, provided that one of these four conditions is satisfied. The first one, the strictly outer subdifferential slope is strictly positive. The boundary slope is strictly positive. Zero doesn't belong to the subdifferential of f at x bar. Or, and the fourth condition is zero belongs to the interior of the subdifferential. Okay? And moreover, condition one is also necessary for f to have a local error bound at x bar. And all these slopes are given by this set of inequalities. And you know that you see from this inequality is 5, that a function has a local error bound if this number is strictly positive, if and only if this number is strictly positive. So you see that if this is strictly positive, you have error bound. If this is strictly positive, you have error bound. If this is strictly positive, you have error bound. But some conditions are weaker or stronger. Okay? They are not equivalent, provided one. And so many people have also worked in this direction. And so, for instance, in blue is related to this. In red is related to this. I will say the difference between blue and red. But some other people. And this was also in our paper with Kruger and Ngai in Siam in 2010. Okay? But I know you know very well this paper.
We know the paper, yes.
I know. Okay, so to summarize with this scheme, so if zero doesn't belong to the subdifferential, so zero doesn't belong to the boundary subdifferential of the subdifferential. So it means that the strict outer subdifferential is strictly positive. It means also you have a local error bound. The same, if zero belongs to the interior of the domain, so zero doesn't belong to the boundary, and so on and so on. Okay? And now, again, you know, I already gave this example, I think. This case, and this case also I gave. So you have strict, inequality. You can have strict inequalities, but so condition two in the last theorem is generally stronger than condition one. Okay, you remember condition two is stronger than condition one because this. Okay? And in fact, it means that, as you will see later, it characterizes a stronger property than just the existence of a local error bound for f. All these things gives local error bounds. But this condition two, this condition two is stronger. This condition two is stronger. It means that it guarantees not only the local bound of F, but of a family of function around F, okay? And which are considered as small perturbation of F. This is a key point now of the discussion, okay? What is this? Okay. So this is just criterion two, some notes about criterion two, which was used also by Penaud, Vu and Ye, Yoffe, Nengai, Henri Antoita, Lyon Giovanni, and so on. And also the requirements for the distance from the origin to the subdifferential of a function at a reference point to be strictly positive while being a conventional sufficient condition for a local or bound for system is far from being necessary. Okay? So, now it's time to define what we call a perturbation, an epsilon perturbation of a function. And so, you have a function f, extended real valued, x bar, a point where in the domain of the function, a point where the function is finite, epsilon positive. And we define this in our paper in 2010 in SIOP. A function f, extended real valued function, is an epsilon perturbation of f near x bar if it coincides with f at x bar, the point. Nominal point, x bar, and also if the limb sup when x goes to x bar of the this quotient, g of x minus f of x over the norm of x minus x bar, is less than epsilon. And we'll denote by PTB f x bar epsilon the collection of all epsilon perturbation of f near x bar. And you see from formula 6 that easily there is a symmetry between f and j, the property of f and j, which means that if j is an epsilon perturbation of f, f is an epsilon perturbation of j. Okay? And also from the definition, we never require neither f nor g to be convex. Okay? And, okay, so for instance, if f equals 0, g of x squared at x bar equals 0, it's an epsilon perturbation for every epsilon. And now, if you consider this family PT f of x bar and epsilon, you have subfamily. You can consider respectively convex and linear epsilon perturbation of f at x, near x bar. So it means that for convex perturbation, you need a perturbation of f such that the difference between g minus f is in the class gamma 0 of x, lower semi-continuous proper function. Or in the case of linear perturbation, you consider also this perturbation in of f such that j has this form where x bar is the dual ball, okay, because it's not necessary in Rn, it could be in a Banach space, okay, a dual ball with radius epsilon, okay? And obviously, from this definition, you see that you have this set of inclusions. So, linear perturbation. A linear perturbation is a convex perturbation, which is a perturbation, okay? And I just want to give you a simple example, a sufficient condition for a function j to be a convex epsilon perturbation of a function f near x bar, okay? I like this result. It's a nice result which use only tools.
And when you put in this sad face in the proposition.
What is smiling, no?
No, it's smiling, it's sad. It's
sad?
Sad.
Yeah.
Oh, it's an error. It should be.
You
I like it. No, it's an error. apologize. okay, but I like to use this kind of symbol, but I didn't. I type in tech a wrong.
From whom you learn just to put these symbols, faces, and signs in the proofs? The first time that I saw such a kind of marks is Stephen Simons.
Also, yeah.
Stephen Simons.
Okay. Stephen Simons, well, it's true. And so, so you see, happily, not sadly, happily, you have a function which is finite, epsilon positive, and you suppose that J equal F, the given function, nominal function, plus P, where P is convex, important, and Lipschitz continuous, more than convex, Lipschitz continuous, near x bar with a constant epsilon, and p of x bar should be zero in order to have g of x bar equal f of x bar. Then j is a perturbation, a convex perturbation of f at x bar with respect to epsilon. And so just a short proof. Because you have to give a proof. As I said in my talk in Alicante recently, I learned this from Frank Clark. Frank Clark is a very good expositor, and so he likes always to give proof. And so you know that P is Lipschitz continuous. So it means that the subdifferential of P at x bar is non-empty, and that x star is less than or equal to epsilon for every x star in the subdifferential of P of x bar. Okay, because the Lipschitz continuous with constant epsilon. Okay, and then if you take an x star in the subdifferential of P at x bar. Okay, you remember that P of x bar equals zero, and you use only the definition of subdifferential. So you have this equal, okay, and you have exactly this inequality. And on the other hand, you obtain this equality. And if you combine the two inequality, you exactly arrive to the definition of epsilon perturbation of F. Okay, this is a simple, but it uses a very nice result and difficult to find, by the way. I remember with Marco and Sacha, we tried to prove it with a hand, and finally we discovered this from Bowen and Wanderwerf. Okay, the assumption of the Lipschitz continuity of P is essential because you have, if it's not the case, we have a counterexample for this function p, okay? Okay, and now, from this definition of epsilon perturbation, when you have a function which is in the class gamma zero of x, with f of x bar equals zero, okay? And you can define the free number by this set of equation 9, okay, the infimum of the error bound of g of x at x bar, of g of x bar for every convex perturbation, for every over all the linear perturbation, and for the perturbation which are in the convex, lower, semi-continuous, and proper, okay, you have. So you can define three different numbers, and since we have this set of inclusion with respect to the perturbation set, you have this set of inequality 10. It means that the set of this number here, okay, is less than equal to this number, and this is equal to this number for any epsilon positive. Okay. And we have this theorem, which is not very good for today, but for Limoges it's often the case. For that reason, I'm using this. It's partly clouded. So if you have a function f in the class gamma 0 of x, always the same assumption, f of x bar equals 0, then the boundary slope of f can be seen as either this number, which are equal. Okay, and you remember this is the condition 2. We say that it is a stronger condition to be strictly positive. This number to be strictly positive ensures not only the fact that f has a local error bound at x bar, but it has the family of epsilon perturbation has also the same error bound at x bar. And this is the main theorem. It is inside. And the perturbation could be convex or linear. We have the same. Okay? What happens here? Okay. It's always. And so this theorem, this is nice because it's hieroglyph. So this theorem stretches one theorem we obtained earlier with a guy Kruger in 2010, his paper, and it established this inequality for any bounds, okay, and also thanks to the theorem, this error bound modulus can be interpreted as the radius of error bound for family of arbitrary or convex or linear, as you said, perturbation of f. Not only of f, but of linear perturbation. Okay, now I will finish I don't know how much time, but we have time.
50 minutes, if
you like. Okay. So, by talking a little bit about infinite constraint system. So, what is an infinite constraint system? You know more than me, probably. So, you have a family of inequalities, F sub t, where the indices are in a compact Hausdorff space. And you suppose that the function t give f sub t of f is continuous on t for every x. You define f of x as the supremum of f sub t of x for t running over t. And this is a notation used by my friend here, t sub f of f equals a set of t in t such that you have f sub t of x equal f of x. You define exactly the same for another function j, okay? And now we define c1 in this way, c2 like this, c3 like this, and from this definition you see that c1 implies c2 and c3 implies c2. Okay, and, now we can prove that C1 implies that if you have C1, okay, this one, it implies that J is necessarily an epsilon perturbation of the given function f. And, okay, this I'm not sure I will use it now. This is the more important fact, is this one. So C1 implies that J is an epsilon perturbation of F. And now we can have this theorem about epsilon perturbation in the case of infinite systems. You suppose that they are convex with f of x bar equals zero. You remember f of x is the supremum of f sub t. And so if you have this, that the boundary slope is greater than tau strictly positive and delta is strictly positive, then you have an epsilon, you can find an epsilon such that any convex g sub t, for any convex g sub t, you have that the modulus of local error bound is strictly positive, strictly greater than tau, provided one of these conditions is satisfied. Zero belongs to the interior subdifferential, C2 and this property, or C3, and it is why it was important to define this, but I went very fast on this, okay? And if the boundary slope is equal to zero, then for any epsilon, you have a convex family of functions G sub T satisfying condition C1, okay? It means that it is an epsilon perturbation of the function, given function F, and satisfy condition C1, and such that the modulus of local error bound is less than epsilon, okay? And as a corollary, we have that the following property are equivalent. The boundary slope is strictly positive, and you have a perturbation of F such that we satisfy this property. Okay? And now I just want to say few words because it's difficult to explain because it's very, very technical if you want to enter into the result. So for global error bounds now, you remember that instead to have the error bound modulus in the neighborhood of X bar, you have the error bound modulus on all the space. Okay? And so for a function f, which is convex, okay, and lower semi-continuous, you suppose that the set S of f, S sub f is non-empty, and you have a global error bound if now you have no longer X bar, okay? You have this number is strictly positive, this number is strictly positive, okay? Okay? This is strict outer error bound modulus and the strict the boundary error bound modulus. And moreover, condition one is also necessary for F to have a global error bound. And you have this inequality, this error bound modulus is less than this one, equal to this one. And okay, you can also prove that you have so this for every x you have this which doesn't depend, which is a projection of zero on the subdifferential of f of x, okay, is always less than the strict outer subdifferential at bound at x. And in fact, you have also that this boundary is infimal of this one when x belongs to the set of x for which f of x equals zero. Okay? And this is the result we obtained in the SIEM paper in 2010. Okay? And it was just to remind you this. And this inequality 13, okay, here, guarantees in particular that you have for any x star in the subdifferential of x such that f of x is greater than zero, strictly greater than zero, then the norm of x star is greater than the boundary slope of f, the global boundary slope. Okay? And I think it's all I want to tell you because we have also result perturbation of for in the global case, but it's very technical. You agree with me? And
you need time just to show the examples to study the
exactly. Exactly. Exactly, it's a little bit complicated. And also I need, because I'm not an expert on this, I need some help for drawing picture in order to have a nice view of what is happening. Okay? Thank you very much, and now it's time to have a glass of wine.
So thank you very much for your talk. Is there any question or comment? Remark? I must say that I'm particularly interested in global error bounds now. Because we started a collaboration with Dean and one of his students, and
Dean from Vietnam.
From Vietnam, yes, yes. He was he suggested us some time ago, even years ago, to start a collaboration, and finally we started. And from Farkas' lemma. Point of view, we are looking for not only local but global error bounds. So I think it is interesting just to check the examples we have with these formulas, mm-hmm. just to try
but
to
increase this. I don't see the connection with Farkas.
The idea is you are looking for a neighborhood where, let's say, the calmness inequality works. The distance is less than or equal calmness constant times the distance between parameters. So you try to get an implication. If the distance between points is less than epsilon, then you have calmness inequalities with k. With constant k. Mm-hmm. So Farkas' lemma provides you a relationship between epsilon and k. And if you look for the infimum k for which there exists an epsilon, you have the calmness modulus, the inverse of the local error bound. Mm-hmm. But if you look for the infimum of k for which you are allowed to take epsilon equal to plus infinite, then you have a global error bound. Mm-hmm. Because if the implication works for all epsilon, that is, you may take a plus infinite, you have a global result. And we have some examples when, then, roughly speaking, you have a polyhedron, you are in a corner, and you have the local error bound, but if you look for the worst corner, you find the global error bound. In some examples.
Oh,
so we have to check and compare with this machinery because I think it is very interesting.
Okay.
You know, we are looking for particular problems, linear problems, let's say easy problems, but we try to deepen them looking for not only the existence of a constant, but mm-hmm. for computing the constant in terms of the nominal data. This is our, let's say, goal. So okay. We are looking for tools for doing this. So
very good.
I find it very interesting.
Okay, you.
Okay.
You keep informed about.
Okay, of course. We are in touch. Some other comments or. Well, in such a case, thank you again.